Hello and welcome everyone. This is Mr. UMath, and in today's video we want to have a look at the great formula derived first by Euler, which is sine of pi z over pi z is equal to this great looking product. If you look at it, this is a product which, if I write it out, this is 1 minus z squared over 1 squared, then 1 minus z squared over 2 squared, and so forth. So this is just a very beautiful formula, and if you just happen to look at these products, you should notice something. If you plug in 1, this is a 0 of the function, and also if you plug in minus 1, this is also a 0 of a function. And if you look at the left hand side, this is the sine, okay, not the sine function itself, but sine of pi z, and you know it has 0 for all the integer values. So for this function over here, and I've written it in this kind of manner because Euler used it to write in this way, but what we will actually prove in this video is that sine of pi z is equal to pi z multiplied with this guy here. Okay, this is what we are going to prove, because it's just easier to prove than this guy here over this. Okay, what we will use for this derivation is Hadamard Factorization Theorem, and it's a little bit confusing at first sight, but if you've done some proofs with it, it is pretty easy to use Hadamard Factorization Theorem. Now let's have a look, what does this say? Okay, Hadamard Factorization Theorem tells us that if we have a entire function, okay, f has to be entire. We will have a look at this, how to show that. If f is a entire function and it has zeros at z equals 0 of multiplicity m, and if you don't have any 0 here, then m is obviously equal to 0 and this term doesn't appear in here, then you take z to the m and multiply this with an exponential function, with a polynomial function here. This is a polynomial. Of order p. Now, what p is, we will find this out also. So, this is a polynomial of order p. And here you see some very strange looking thing, this ep. It has a p in here, and then z over a n. Now what is this ep? These are called the Weierstrass product, I think. And how these look like, it's pretty easy. E to the, not to the, but if the index is n of z is equal to 1 minus z if n is equal to 0. So e 0 of z is just simply 1 minus z. And e to the 1 is, for example, e1 of z is equal 1 minus z. So this term is always in there. And then you have this guy here, the exponential. Because n is equal to 1, we have just simply z over 1. Okay? And so forth. Now, now we had a look, what is m? Okay, we know we have to find out what is m, and if you look at the sine function, you might say that it has only one zero in zero. Okay, this is first order, so our m will be equal to 1. Then what we will also want to find out is all the other zeros of sine. And this might sound very, very easy, but we forgot about the complex plane. So we have to have a look if this thing, or better, this guy has zeros for complex values. And then we have to find this p here. Oh, let me look here, this p. And in order to find this p, it's very easy. If you have a look at sums like this, 1 plus p over the magnitude of all the zeros of your function for n equals 1 to infinity. If this is convergent for all r, for all positive r, then this is our order. Okay, we find the minimal number p for which this kind of relationship, this kind of convergence is given. And very importantly, these are non-zero. Non-zero zeros of f. Okay, so this is what we've done, or better, what we want to do is we want to use Hadamard's factorization theorem in order to prove this very great theorem. Okay, now let's start off with a very important question. What is an entire function? So is, and I will now, we don't have a look at sine of pi z, we just have a look at pi z, because if a function, if f of z is entire, then f of some variable k multiplied with the z is also entire. Okay, so we just have a look, so k in this case would be pi, so we will only have a look at sine of z, and if you remember Euler's formula, then you can rewrite this in the following manner, minus e to the minus I z over 2i. So very simple formula. And now we break this up into a complex, into a real and imaginary part. So x plus I y, and then we get ix plus iy minus e minus ix plus iy and over 2i. Now what we will have to do is simplify this a little bit. I won't go into the details how to do this, but the important part is at the end we want to see something like this. Some function u, x, y. So you want to split up this part into its real part and its imaginary part. Then you want to add I, v of x and y. Okay? Now, why do I want to do this? Because now we can use the most important theorem in complex analysis or functional analysis called the Cauchy-Riemann differential equations, because now we can test if this function, this sine of z, is holomorphic, and if it's holomorphic, then it is also entire. So if you want to show that your function is entire, just use the Cauchy-Riemann equations, which are pretty easy. You just have to use this u over x, so you just differentiate this real part in respect to x, then you differentiate the v in respect to y, and then, so this has to be true, and also we have to show that if you differentiate u in respect to y, and you differentiate u in, sorry, not u, I'll just delete this, so minus del of v over del x. So these are the both things that we have to show, and it's actually pretty easy. It's just a straightforward calculation here, nothing very, very fancy. If you like, we could go through that, and maybe I will do a separate video on showing that the sine of z is entire, and maybe also, but it's much easier to show that the exponential function is entire, because from that, you know, if you add or subtract entire functions, you still get an entire function. So this is a very easy way to show that sine of z is entire. But if you go through all these steps, you can show that sine of z is entire. And from that, you follow that sine of pi of z is also entire. Okay, so we can do a lot of things with it. We can differentiate this function infinitely many times. This is very important. And yeah, so this was the first part, which I didn't go through in all that detail, but you can see what is coming here. It's pretty easy to go through and then differentiate this U, the real part, and the imaginary part, and then see that these kind of differential equations are true, and sine of z is hence entire. Now we do the second thing, which is, I think, more interesting, because maybe you would not have thought about it. We want to have a look at all the zeros from sine of z. Now we know that sine of z can be written as iz minus iz over 2i, and we want to find out the zeros from that function. Okay, now what we will do is we will simply say that we don't mind about this part here. Okay, we don't mind about this part, so because this cannot be zero, so this is unequal zero, so from that we follow that e to the iz minus eiz equals zero. And maybe I should stop at this point and tell you why we are actually doing this, because I know you know all the zeros, so the zeros of sine z, you know them. Okay, you know we have so to say minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, and so forth, and here also you know not of sine z but of this guy here, pi of sine z. Okay, you know all of them. This is not the important part in this kind of derivation, but what is now important is, are there any complex zeros? Okay, we don't, for example, this equation, maybe I should also write it, z squared plus 1 equals 0, doesn't have any zeros in the real plane, but it has zeros in the complex plane. Now this is the same question. We want to find out if sine of z has any complex zeros. Now what I will do right now is I will just multiply it with iz here. Okay, on the left hand side we get i 2iz. Here this guy and this guy will, I will just rewrite it, iz, and here on the left hand side we are still left with zero. Okay, nothing special happened in here. Now if you have a look at these guys, because we have exponentials, we can rewrite this as minus iz plus iz, and these guys will add up to e to the zero, and e to the zero is just simply one. Now next step is what we have gotten right now is e to the 2iz is equal to 1, because this was equal to 1, and if we bring it to the right hand side we just have this simple equation. Now how do we solve equations of this type? We rewrite this as e to the i 0 plus 2 pi k. Okay, because e to the 1, remember, in the complex plane, so we have here x, which is the real part, and here the other part. So what we know is that in the unit circle, if you have a look at this, I hope I can draw it in. Okay, it looks like a, here we have 1. This is, so to say, I. And what you should see from that is that the angle here is equal to 0. Or better, the arc length. The arc length is 0, but because we can do 2 pi rotations rotations all the way, we can rewrite this in this manner. And now things get really, really easy, because we have now an equation that is pretty easy. E to the 2iz is equal to e to the 2 pi k. And from that we follow that all the zeros are a form pi k. Okay, there are no complex solutions, or better, no complex zeros. Okay, that's almost all that we need. Okay, so we found out that the sine of z is an entire function, Actually, I didn't go through all these steps. Maybe I will do soon, or sooner or later. We found out that all the zeros of sine of pi z, actually we did this for sine of z, but you can really easily translate it, the proof that we did in here, to sine pi of z. And we found out that these are all the integer values. There are no complex values as zeros. Now, what do we do? What do we have to do next? So we know that the order of the zero. So let's go up a little bit here. Let's have a look at this. So what we have to do is we know that f of z is entire. We know that f of z is equal to z to the first order, because we have only a first order zero in z equals zero, e to the gz multiplied with n equals 1 ep. Now this is the next interesting stuff, and very important, these ans are like this, so 1 minus 1, 2 minus 2, 3 minus 3, and so forth. These are all the non-zero zeros. The only zero that is zero, it's written here in front of this. Now, what do we have to do next? In order to find this p, we want to have a look at this equation, and this is r a n, and we take this to 1 over p, and we have to find out p, that this guy, a integer value of p, that this guy converges, okay? And now what we can do is, actually we can rewrite this guy here as 2 times r a 2n. Now, why did I do this? Okay, if you see, 1 and minus 1 will just give the same term for this kind of expression. So we get r 1 magnitude to the 1 plus p, and we get plus r the absolute value of minus 1, 1 plus p. And hence, this is 2 times r over 1. 1, or let's do, let's just rewrite this 1p, and remember that the magnitude, so an 2n minus 1 is equal to a 2, okay, sorry, 2n. Now what this tells us is if we plug in n equals 1, we get 1. If we plug in n equals 2, we get minus 1, but from the magnitude, these guys are the same. So I have written it down like this. I could have written it with this guy, but it's just simpler to do it with this kind of expression. And now we can just directly write down what our zeros are. Okay, we know that the zeros are all integer values, and if I take always the second guy, so this is a of 2, this is a of 4, and so forth, then you see this is nothing else than n. Okay, this is n minus n 1 plus p. Let's just rewrite it. So we found out that e r, the magnitude of an, 1 plus p is equal to 2 times the sum, and remember the n is going from 1 to infinity. Very important, if you only have a finite number of zeros, then it's pretty easy to see that this is not going to infinity, because there are no infinitely many zeros of the function, but the sine function has actually infinitely many. So n, so we said that this is the magnitude of minus n, which is just n, and 1 plus p. Okay, now what you should see in here is if p is equal to 0, what will happen is we will get the divergent harmonic sum. Okay, we will get something like this. We will get, I'll just write it here, 2 times any number r over n, and you know this is greater than infinity. Okay, maybe I should not write it down like this. This is divergent, goes to infinity. Okay, sorry for my bad handwritings. So actually you see that p equals 0 does not work, so let's try p equals 1. What do we get then? So we just have a look at this kind of sum, and this is r, n here is squared, and you see that r is not depending on n, so we can take r squared out of the sum, so we get 2r squared, and then we have this very beautiful sum. You should know it, and if you don't know it, then shame on you, but this is a very famous proof going, which was first proven by Euler, and you can show that this is equal to pi squared over 6, the sum. It doesn't mind, it isn't important to actually show this value. You can also use this sum as a upper bound to this, and then show that this is converging, and you can easily do this by using telescope sums, which is, let me just write it down, 1 n minus 1 plus n, no, it should be minus. So you can break this up by, okay, minus 1 over n. Yes, this should turn out to be the same as here. And if you look at this kind of sum, if you write it down, you see that this is equal to 1, if we go to m, 1 minus 1 over m. Okay, and you can easily see that this is convergent because the partial sums are convergent and so forth. So a lot of trash talk here, but the big result, the essence of what I've told you, is that we have found our p, which is equal to 1. P is equal to 1. Now let's go back to this equation. We know that f of z is equal to z to the 1, and remember we are actually looking at sine pi of z, okay, is some function, and here I told you already that this g of z is some kind of polynomial of order p. Okay, bad marking, it has order p, meaning that this is some kind of ax, oh no, not ax, we need to az plus b multiplied with this guy here, e of 1, we will write it down what this means, and these guys. Now let's rewrite what we found out. So this is 1 e to the az plus b, and this product I already told you, this is equal to 1 minus z. Now the exponential of z over 1, because remember the formula here above, where is it here, it told us if n is equal to p, okay, and we know that p is equal, so our n is p equals 1 right now, that means we can break this sum over here, okay. And I already did a little mistake in here, let's get down here. Okay, I'll just delete it. If you noticed my error, okay, just delete this guy, this whole guy. So we need a product, and my error was that I plugged in z and not z over an. So minus z over an, and then we need the exponential term, which is z over an, okay? No, not over, this is okay. Now, I will do a little another step, because you know that ans are 1 and minus 1 and so forth. I will break this product up into two products, okay? So let's rewrite this. C e to the az plus b, and this is this product, n equals 1, and now I will take the positive zeros, 1 minus z which are just n. So this is n equals 1. This guy would be n equals 2. And we need e to the z over n. Okay, now we do the same thing. We break this product here up into two parts. We do the same thing with the negative values, which are just minus n. So what will happen here is minus z minus n e to the z over minus n. Okay, now let's just comprehend this stuff here. Z e to the az plus b pi infinitely large value in here equals 1. And then what you should see is this guy is equal to 1 plus z over n. And if we multiply this guy and this guy, you should see by the third binomial formula that this just comprehends to 1 minus z squared over n squared. So you, if you don't trust me, just multiply this out and you will see that this is the result. And again, here we have two exponentials. So we have z over n, and we multiply this minus z over n. So this minus here, I took it in front of the fraction, and now I can combine these guys here by using the exponential laws, the laws of exponentials, and you see that this is e to the 0. So this exponential term vanished out of our discussion. Very, very nice. And we are almost done. The only problem that we have here is this a and this b. Okay, they are very, very disturbing. Now let's go to a new page, and these are almost the last steps that we do, because now I will just write it: sine of pi z is equal to z e to the az plus b. Okay, n equals 1 minus z squared n squared. Okay, now we will do two things in order to so we need two conditions which we know about the sine function in order to evaluate or fix a and b. Okay, how do we do that? First of all, I'm using a very, very simple law telling us that sine of minus pi z, so I plug in, I replace z with minus z. We know that this is equal to minus sine of pi z. Okay, and if we plug this into this formula, we get minus, because we plugged in for z minus z, this is this, and e to the minus az plus b. And here in this kind of product, nothing will change, okay? There is no change at all. N equals 1, and 1 minus z squared over n squared, because the square, if you take minus z to the square, it just stays z squared, okay? This is the first thing that we use, that the sine is a odd function. And you know what odd functions are. If you plug in minus x, you get minus f of minus x out of it. The cosine is a even function. For that, it would be this equation. Now, okay, we did that and it looks beautiful. Now let's just look at this right hand side, and what we see then is sine of pi z, because this minus and this minus will cancel, is equal to z to the e minus az plus b equals 1 minus z squared n squared. And now by comparing both of these equations, they can only be true if a is equal to 0. Okay, you could also divide this equation by each other and see that a has to be equal to 0. So from that we follow that a is equal to 0. That is cool, because now we see that sine of pi z is equal to z multiplied with e to the b pi infinitely large here. I always say that this is pi, but actually it means pi for product, but p for product, but I should rather not say this. I think you hate it, or okay. Now the next step that we have to do is to find this b. So we evaluated using that the sine was a odd function. We evaluated this kind of formula. Now the last step that we have to go, which is very very easy, is we use the other condition. We know that sine of pi z is, if we plug in z equals 0, we get 0. Okay, now if we do that, this would crap out the stuff out of us, because if we do that, we get 0 here, we get 0 here, and we don't get any information. So what we have to do is we have to divide this equation by z. Okay. I'll just rewrite it so we're at the same spot. So we divide this by z, assuming that z is unequal to 0. So z is not equal to 0. And what we will do right now is, now we have rewritten it in this way. Problem is we can't plug in z equals 0. So what do we do? We do the limit. So we say that limit for z to 0 sine of pi z over z is equal to the limit on this side, z to 0, e to the b, and the product, n equals 1, 1 minus z squared n squared. You see that this guy is constant, so it doesn't matter in the product. And if here z goes to 0, we just get 1. So this right-hand side is e to the b. And the left-hand side, if you have a look at it, I hope you know from classical calculus, you should know this result. Okay, not sales, but sine of z over z for z to 0 is equal to 1. Okay, now the problem is we don't have sine of z here, we have sine of pi z. How do we complete it? We just rewrite this with a pi in here and we multiply with a pi in here. Okay, so now it is pretty easy to see that this guy has a limit of 1. So our result is pi is equal to e to the b, and we take the logarithm, and remember b is not a complex number. But even if you assume it to be complex, the left-hand side isn't complex. So we have ln of pi equals e, and not e, equals b. And this is our result. And if we just plug this back into this equation, we get sine of pi z. So even if b would be assumed to be complex, you could show that this is only real. Okay? Yeah, let's go on. So we found out this is equal to z e to the ln of pi, the product from n equals 1, 1 minus z squared n squared. And now you should be happy, actually, because if we take the limit of this guy here, not the limit, sorry, if you have a look at this, this is just equal to pi. So let's take a new slide and write down this beautiful formula. Maybe I should show you this previous step. We found out this is equal to pi, because if you take the exponential of a logarithm, then you get the argument out of it. So we have found that sine of pi z is equal to pi multiplied with z, and then this product term, sorry for this ugly product term here, 1 minus z squared over n squared. Okay, this is just a beautiful result that Euler derived, and actually he didn't do this by this rigorous proof, but remember what we needed. First of all, we had to show that first f of z here it's the sine of pi z. We show that this is entire using Cauchy-Riemann differential equations. Okay, this is the acronym for that, but you know what I mean. So that ux is equal to v del y, and at the same time u del y is equal to del v over del x. So this is Cauchy-Riemann. Then we found out all zeros of f, and then we found out find p, and then the last thing was to use known stuff about your function and then derive it. Now, how do we arrive at this formula that I had in the first slide or first page? Oh man, this is ugly. This kind of touchpad stuff is really, really bad. I don't know how to improve my writing on this kind of stuff. Normally I have a good handwriting, but here it really sucks, and I'm really sorry that you guys have to endure this ugly stuff that I write in here. But this beautiful formula completes this beautiful video, and I hope you guys will have a beautiful day and you had a real mathematical inspiration by this video, and go ahead and do this kind of Hadamard analysis for all kind of functions that are interesting to you, for example the gamma function or anything like this, because one can also show the Weierstrass product formulation of the gamma function using this kind of procedure. Okay, yes, that's actually concluding my lecture. If you still have questions, some inspirations to do new videos, please feel free to leave some comments. And if you like my videos, like always, just subscribe and stay tuned for my new upcoming videos. So see you guys.